From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Hello, and welcome to our listeners around the world. Thank you for joining us on this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I am your host, Dr. Melissa Simon, an editor at JAMA. Today, I'm joined by Dr. Daniel Grossman to discuss his new JAMA Insights article on over-the-counter oral contraceptives. Hello, Dr. Grossman. It's so good that you're here today. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the invitation. It's really great to be here.
Well, this is a real treat because I actually did a podcast on this topic before the Opill was officially over the counter about a year ago. So Dr. Grossman, can you please remind our audience, what is the Opill?
So Opill is a progestin-only pill. It's norgestrel, 75 microgram tablet that's taken daily for regular contraception. The really exciting thing about it is that this is the first daily oral contraceptive that FDA has approved for over-the-counter sales. And just to state the other thing that's really exciting is that it was approved without an age restriction, so it's available for people of all ages.
That's amazing. So who does this impact and why?
Well, you know, it's really interesting in the research that's been done looking at who is interested in an over-the-counter oral contraceptive. We see broad interest across a range of demographics. In studies that were done, again, before Opill was approved, about 40% of adult women of reproductive age and about 30% of young people, minors, said that they were interested in using an over-the-counter oral contraceptive if one were available. Certainly, people who currently face barriers accessing clinic-based care, people who might not have insurance, also just people who might run out of their pills and need to resupply in a hurry and might not be able to easily get it resupplied from a clinician, could pick up an over-the-counter option.
This is the first over-the-counter pill for the United States. So how does that compare to other countries around the world with respect to over-the-counter oral contraceptive access?
Yeah, and some of the research that we did kind of building the evidence base around this possibility of a change to over-the-counter access, we looked at what the policies were in other countries. And in fact, in over 100 countries worldwide, people have access to oral contraceptives without a prescription. So in some of those countries, it's actually been approved by a regulatory body to be available over the counter. And in others, it's available de facto. So even though it technically should require a prescription, if you go into a pharmacy, you can get it without one. And that's the case in much of Latin America. This move by FDA is, even though there are so many countries that have access without a prescription already, it hasn't yet been available over the counter in most countries in Europe, in Australia, New Zealand, Japan. So it's an important move that FDA has made, and I think it will set a precedent that we might see other kinds of switches in these other countries as well.
So can you walk us through how is Opill used?
Yes. So again, this is a progestin-only pill. And like all progestin-only pills, it needs to be taken every day at about the same time every day. And it doesn't have a pill-free window or pill-free week or use of a placebo. So you just keep taking the pill every day. And it is important that it's taken at the same time every day. The evidence that we have suggests that progestin-only pills like norgestrel may be a little less forgiving than the combined oral contraceptives. If a pill is taken more than 3 hours late, it's considered missed.
Thank you. So how safe is Opill? And can you walk us through any potential adverse events or side effects?
Opill, like all progestin-only pills, are very, very safe. And the only category 4 contraindication to use, according to the medical eligibility criteria, is current breast cancer. And so things like hypertension, cigarette smoking, those are not considered contraindications to a progestin-only pill, whereas they may be, especially cigarette smoking for age 35 or over for the combined pills. Adverse effects are very rare. In terms of serious adverse effects, there's clear evidence that there's no association with increased risk of venous thromboembolism with progestin-only pills, so that is not a concern. The main adverse effect that patients may experience is irregular bleeding, and that can be common with a progestin-only pill like norgestrel.
So I want to emphasize, you said high blood pressure and also cigarette smoking. This pill is okay and safe to use.
Exactly. And I think that's really an important thing to stress, that really this pill is safe for almost anybody who might be interested in using it.
There is an excellent, absolutely excellent table in this manuscript. And by the way, for our listeners, the link to the manuscript is in the show notes. And I just want to walk through it because it's really important, I think, for all clinicians who prescribe or recommend birth control pills to actually hear some of these tips and tricks and hints and ways to troubleshoot. So I'm going to walk through that table with you, if you don't mind. So what if an Opill user takes a pill more than 3 hours late? So 3 hours is really that time window about when you need to take this pill every day. It's within 3 hours of the last time you took the pill. Or if they vomit or have diarrhea within 3 hours of taking the pill. So what if the Opill user takes a pill more than 3 hours late or vomits or has diarrhea?
What someone should do is first take the pill that they missed as soon as they can, and then keep taking the regular pill at the regular time. They should avoid sexual intercourse or use a backup form of contraception for the next 48 hours. So that's a little bit different from what we say from the combined pill. But the thought is that it takes another 48 hours of being back on the pill until you get the contraceptive effect again. If the person had unprotected sex around that time of the missed pill, then they should also consider using the levonorgestrel emergency contraception if that happened.
And then they take the levonorgestrel emergency contraception, which is also available over the counter, and then they continue to use the Opill that next day.
Yes, just keep taking it every day.
Thank you. That's very important clarification. Next, how should clinicians address irregular vaginal bleeding that you mentioned as one of the side effects while taking the Opill?
I think it's important if a patient comes and asks about this, it would be good to ask them about whether they've been taking the pill as directed at the same time every day, if there's any possibility that they might have missed a dose and maybe not used a backup contraception appropriately, then it's certainly reasonable to possibly talk about using emergency contraception if someone is in that window for using that, or to do a pregnancy test just to confirm that they're not pregnant. If the spotting or intermenstrual bleeding is not bothersome, then you can really just reassure the patient and tell them that often that will get better with time, generally within about 6 months. Often with continued consistent use, the bleeding pattern will become more regular or less bothersome. If the bleeding is bothersome for the patient, one thing to consider is a course of a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug such as ibuprofen, used at a dose of 400 to 800 milligrams three times a day for 5 to 10 days, and that may reduce the irregular bleeding. If it's really bothersome, of course, the patient can consider changing to another method. And of course, if the patient is continuing to have persistent bleeding that seems abnormal, that should be worked up.
In terms of things like quick start, when in the menstrual cycle should Opill be started? And when should one use backup contraception?
If someone starts the Opill within the first 5 days of their menstrual cycle, that's fine. And they should be protected right away. If they start it at any other time, it's important that they use a backup method for the first 48 hours or avoid sexual intercourse.
At what age can people who are reproductive capable take Opill, and can minors purchase without parental consent?
Anybody who is menstruating can take Opill, and it's safe for people of all ages. And as we mentioned, the really exciting thing, I think the real success, or one of the real successes of this approval by FDA, is that there is no age restriction. So people of all ages can access this across the country. They should be able to access it without parental consent. There's no age restriction.
So last year, when I did the podcast on this topic, we speculated that cost and accessibility would be the driving factors on who is most likely to use the Opill. And part of that table in your manuscript mentions what the manufacturer's suggested retail price is and if insurance covers Opill. So can you please comment on that?
Yeah. So the manufacturer's suggested retail price of Opill is $19.99. There is some reduction if people purchase more than one pack at a time. I believe it's $49.99 for 3 months and $89.99 for 6 months. you know, I think that this cost will be a barrier for some people. In some of the research that we did before Opill was approved, we found that among adults that were interested in an over-the-counter oral contraceptive, the most that they were willing to pay on average per month was about $15. And for teens, it was about $10, again, on average per month. I do worry that this is going to be out of reach for some people. But the really good news is, you know, it used to be that when something went over-the-counter, it was no longer covered by insurance. But I think there's been a real move and some tremendous advocacy work around trying to get insurance coverage for over-the-counter contraception. I believe that there are now 9 states that have even passed legislation mandating insurance coverage of over-the-counter contraception, kind of waiting to see how that's going to be implemented. Some other states are doing some other innovative strategies to try to get coverage. In Wisconsin, for example, the governor issued a standing order for Opill that's going to allow Medicaid coverage for beneficiaries there. So there are just some really exciting things that are happening. I'm really optimistic that we're going to see more of that even over the next year. And then also just to note that the manufacturer, Perrigo, also has a cost assistance program. And if people who are purchasing the product go onto their website, they can find out how to apply for that.
That's fantastic. Thank you for sharing that. And an exemplar of great advocacy work being done across the nation. So very exciting. Dr. Grossman, what comes next in terms of the future of over-the-counter contraceptives?
Yeah, I think this is really exciting. You know, this is just the first daily oral contraceptive to go over the counter here in the US. And I'm pretty hopeful that we'll be seeing more. And we might see other progestin-only pills going over the counter in the near future. The progestin-only pills currently represent a small market share of all the oral contraceptive users. So I really hope that we will also see a combined oral contraceptive going over the counter sometime soon, because that's the formulation that more people are familiar with, and more people have had experience using. And then I think this also just sets a precedent for other reproductive health medications as well. And I think that medication abortion with mifepristone and misoprostol likely meet the FDA's criteria for over-the-counter sale. And I hope there'll be more research on that topic as well.
Fantastic. That is super exciting all across the board. Thank you so much for sharing your insights and knowledge. And thank you for publishing this article. It was fantastic. And thank you for all that you do, Dr. Grossman. It was a pleasure to get to speak with you today.
Thank you so much for the invitation. It was great to talk with you as well.
All right. I want to remind our listeners that the link to the manuscript is in the show notes, and that this episode was produced by Shelley Steppens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thank you so much for listening. Have a wonderful day.